The legacy of Rogernomics, the radical economic and social reforms of the 1980s, still divides Aotearoa, at least if your views are anything to go by. As soon as we started promoting my interview with Sir Roger Douglas, there was a swift flurry of feedback from those who consider him a saviour and those who firmly believe he's a traitor to the New Zealand way of life. Sir Roger, I suspect, wouldn't be too bothered, having weathered the disapproval of those who despised his so-called neoliberal reforms nearly 35 years ago. I visited him at his home near Auckland to discuss his legacy, whether he had any regrets, and to ask what he makes of Jacinda Ardern's Labor government.
We're through the jungle, mate.
At 81, Sir Roger Douglas has no interest in gardening.
Is this your handiwork, Sir Roger?
No, not at all. My wife wouldn't let me near it.
He's lived in the same family home for more than 30 years, since the sweeping economic reforms he pushed through as the fourth Labor government's finance minister.
We were going backwards for nearly 30 years because of the controls that had locked the economy up to the point that it was only borrowing that kept it going.
It's 35 years since those reforms of 1984. How would New Zealand look today if you hadn't introduced those reforms?
A whole lot worse. I think if you look at the reforms, particularly between 84 and 87, those reforms are still in place. Despite a lot of my former colleagues like Helen Clark and others decrying them, they didn't change one of them. So they're still there, and I think that's proof of principle that they were quality reforms.
How far would you have liked to have gone with those reforms?
Well, in the end, I would have wanted to move into the social policy area. And it was really in that area where David Longhi and, we parted company, as it were. But without a doubt, by 1987, most of the economic reforms were either in place or were in the process of being in place. But we had not made any changes to the social policy area, which was 80% of the budget, and most of those areas were failing.
What do you mean by those social policies? Are you talking about
about education, I'm talking about health, I'm talking about welfare. No, it's about a lot about delivery. The institutions which had originally been set up as conduits to take government money and spend it on behalf of consumers had taken on a life of their own, and the consumer was being left out. David Longhi had a simple philosophy. His view was that unless the state actually provided the health care and the education and ran those institutions, some right-wing government could come along later on and wipe it. My attitude was that individual people needed to make those choices for themselves. They needed to have the power to do so.
Do you have any regrets from that period?
Well, of course, I would have liked, I have a regret, I would have liked to have done what I believe still needs to be done. Because if you look at the issues I raised there, another 30 years on, we're still in trouble and we're in a lot deeper trouble. And we talk about inequality. We talk about all those things, and particularly the left, my old colleague, but they haven't got a clue how to solve it.
There will be those, though, who say that neoliberal reforms, like the ones you introduced in New Zealand, have contributed to massive inequality around the world, that over the last 40 years, inequality has just increased at an incredible rate, that it's led to the rise of populism. How do you answer those criticisms?
I would say it's not the policies I put in place. It's the policies that people like Helen and John Key did. Where did their money go? It went to the rich. Helen Clark's decision to subsidise rich children into their secondary, into their university education, that was transferring money from the poor to the rich. their decision, her decision to agree to Jim Anderton's help to big business.
What about in a broader global context, though? Because we've seen inequality rise everywhere. Are you saying that by subsidising university?
In the main, I'm saying that it's the left wing who have handed out the privilege. And if they had left that money with low income workers, they'd be better off.
What do you think of the current political landscape in New Zealand?
Not much. I don't think really we're going to make any significant changes. It's a tragedy. I can't see anything that's going to improve our productivity. And at the end of the day, we can say what we like, that we care for people, and all of us do, but unless we can lift our productivity in New Zealand, we're going nowhere. There's only been 4 or 5 years in the last 60 where our productivity has been in the top, sector of the OECD, and that was in after the changes that I put in place and Ruth put in place. Otherwise, we've been the bottom of the heap, and unless we do something about changing that, we're not going to get there.
Why isn't ACT resonating?
I think largely because they're not sticking to their knitting. I think we had a philosophy that if you go back to where we started, Common Sense for a Change, we were saying that we had a new way of delivering in old areas like health, education. The whole thing was based on helping the low income and the poor. And we said, these are the policies that you need to put in place if you're going to actually do something for the disadvantaged. And I guess they got trapped in a way, and I can understand it. They looked at who was voting for it. It's all the affluent people. So they started targeting, their message. Look, we got David is a very smart guy, but he's trying to cover too much. And I'm not sure euthanasia is what a leader of a party should be advocating. Auckland City Council's a disaster. That should have been more efficient. That was never going to be.
Last I checked, the minister who pushed that reform through was an ACT party leader.
Yeah, but I didn't agree with it.
Today, Sir Roger Douglas still holds strong views on big government.
I don't want some mad greenie sitting in Queen Street making my decisions for out here. I'd rather have some local people here.
Yeah.
You're not quoting me on mad greenies, are you?
And he has the space to take stock of his years in Parliament.
How do you remember someone like Longy?
Oh, David. My regret is that he's not going to be remembered as a great Prime Minister. He's going to be remembered as an average Prime Minister who, for a period of time, got things done. That is a tragedy because he could have been a great Prime Minister. And for a period of time, his first year in office, he was a great Prime Minister. He had the capacity, he had skills that were incredible, really. I remember taking a report to him one day, 4 pages, and he gets a report and he goes, "Oh, that looks all right, Rog." And I thought, "You haven't read that, you can't have." So I thought, "Oh, I'll ask you a question about," put it nicely. He damn well knew it better than I did, And he had that capacity, and for the first year when he was switched on, he was tremendous. But I think he listened to the wrong people, and in a way he lost his way.
Sir Roger Douglas is pushing on, his passion for economic reform unabated. He's currently researching and writing a book with a new economic plan, which he believes would end inequality in New Zealand.